So the evolution through 5 retreats has been the capacity to read the people that come in, changing a little bit of the workouts, the movements and constraints. I think that each time I get a little bit more zoned in on how to most effectively give people a certain lesson to be learned. So with that being said, it's also understanding that you don't need to give it to them in a silver platter, and that the change or the epiphanies come from the work that they put in. So I used to want to give all of the information before the workouts, and I feel that now I'm creating a simpler version, but it's that much more complex in the sense that I know when to give the right cues or words of encouragement, when to give the epiphany moments for each person based on the first day of how connected or disconnected I see them, and what is the troubles that we need to work through. So I think that's been part of the biggest evolution. I think showing consistency, so now people are having a lot more buy-in as to, I just want to go for the experience and see what I learn from it. So it's starting to be a lot less direct as a problem that needs to be fixed for somebody, but more of, I want to see how much more movement can do for me than just trying to look good naked or, you know, get stronger. I think the Croatia retreat was special in the sense that we had the beautiful setting. The people that came were all willing to just have an experience. And it was really cool because we had this sort of split of repeat people and people that have not done it and had no understanding and are very analytical and just had a very different view of what movement can do, but there was curiosity there. So I think it was really cool to see the capacity for the people that have done it to open up, and then that opening allows other people to not analyze so much and just really have a movement experience, if you will. I think it was a really fun group. It's always kind of eclectic. I mean, we're in Croatia. It's kind of difficult to get here. And we have people from Australia, the US, UK, Iceland. So it's a really cool thing to see people from all over the world gathering. And you get to see how much more the human connection is just so powerful. So I think that's the beauty of it, is all the humans come from such different walks of life. But when we all kind of gather together, and again, the biggest thing is this sort of socializing and community. For me, it's just being present. So like the food was big, just cooking at home and just being able to hang out and socialize with people. I think that's one of the most special things, especially with this one. I think we made a pretty tight-knit group of people that are now friends.
What can movement do?
Everything. I think that the quickest way to change is an active approach to change. And again, it's beautiful when you have these sort of extreme cases, not extreme, right? But you have these cases or these people that come in that are from a very intense background, and the capacity to be able to see them transition with movement. It's the most, I think for me, it's the quickest acting way to get the body and the brain to understand each other. And once we can break down this analytical narrative that the body is just for movement, we can understand how much more it has to do with how it observes the world and how it reacts in the world. It's everything, right? So, I mean, you have sunlight at a cellular level. I think at a macro level, movement is the thing that can keep you the healthiest long term.
What are some of your favorite stories from this?
I always say there's no easy fixes, and we're going to open up doors and we're going to get some epiphany moments of where you have your own roadblocks. And I think the coolest stories was seeing Jody coming in and taking her road to healing, right? What, you know, having this journey, but she's now past this sort of, I'm going to tick the boxes and now I'm really ready to explore. So this was her second retreat and she was really able to just see what exploration can do for her. So she's gone from having these cycles of, you know, some negative narrative brain to now wanting to develop her self-love and her self-confidence. And it's, you know, a lot of the changes have been done through movement, with Callie. Just there was that one moment where you could just tell that like everything just lined up, right? So the heart, the breathing, the muscle contractions, the environment, everything just lined up perfectly for her to have this beautiful epiphany moment and this sort of realization of why she's been having these blocks and the discomfort in her body for so long, and that no longer needs to be there. Now, it's a beautiful story, but the best part is now there's tools in play where she can go home and continue to develop this so she doesn't go back to those behavioral patterns or back to that pain.
And there were some moments in the retreat where people cried and also some where people laughed. What do you see in those moments?
I think that we put emotions in a pedestal as it is, and so expressions are a way for us to let go of energy that is being felt currently, or excitation that's being felt currently, and that's not to take away from the conscious brain and the, you know, society and everything, but I think that the way that we perceive sadness could be in a joyful state or in a sad, you know, angry or depressive negative state. Same with anger, it could be a wonderful thing, you know, it could be rough and primal, or it could be rage. So seeing people having these expressions for me is more of the body starting to let go of old behavioral patterns, meaning that you're no longer having to analyze and think about them so much. You realize that you have passed it. And so the crying is a sign of sadness that can be brought up from winning a fight, and the laughter is a sign of a flow state after winning a fight, right? And that fight is an aggressive, sympathetic expression at a cellular level, at a muscular level, where we've had these changes and they've spoken loudly enough to the brain to change how we're going to observe and predict our world. And so I think that's what neither are good or bad. There's laughter, there's crying, there's screaming. I think that they're all just ways for you to let out energy that's been stuck inside of you to change how you're going to be observing and predicting the world around you. Who shouldn't come to Movement Ayahuasca? Anybody that thinks that this is going to be the retreat that's going to save them. It's not the retreat that's going to save you. I'm not your savior. I'm not a cult leader. I'm not trying to prove to you that I can heal you. That's not the point. It's for people that want to put the work in. So again, this is the opening of the doors. I will give you and guide you for you to see what you want to see. But if people are coming in, I don't mind if you're skeptical, but if people are wanting to come in and not put in the work, that's where you can say there's no point in coming, right? The people that think that after this retreat, they're going to be feeling 10,000% better and they're going to go back to their day-to-day job and not have to do anything, any of the homework that's been given from here or put in any more work afterwards, should probably not come to this. They probably shouldn't go anywhere else because they're just not ready to make the change anyways. So I think that it's more about, I want people that want to put in the work. I'm not here to put in the work for you. I'm just here to guide you and show you the roadblocks that you may have in stressful situations.
In practical terms, what does the homework, the plan going forward, to look like to people from physical and emotional perspective?
Yeah, so there's the capacity to express past events through movement, and that comes in a matter of different practices. So, you know, one of the homeworks I gave out was write a letter to whoever you were feeling this way towards, and then go do an expression workout. And the entire intent of this expression workout, right, is to all of the movement, all of the energy that's being forced in these movements is going towards that letter. You know, that's on the very specific side, having regular routines added in, right? And then from there we have a follow-up. So it's always a, I work on cycles. So it's how many weeks or how many days before you fall off the cycle. So when we come here, we wake up, we watch the sunrise, we go for a walk, we do a couple quick exercises, then have breakfast and go on with our day. If you can keep that up, great. As soon as you fall off the wagon and we have a conversation, you fall off, then I take that time frame and I look at that cycle, and that's usually when you're going to start to feel good, because you're going to change everything about yourself and then you fall down. So again, the healing isn't linear, and I don't expect it to be. I expect you to feel really good leaving from here. And then I just want to see when that crash happens and how long it takes for you to notice when that downfall is happening. And that's okay, because we all fall back down. And so the goal there is the movement, the breathing, the swami, the exercises, daily exercises that you're given should help you maintain an upward trajectory. But when everything feels good, you feel comfortable, you get lazy, and you stop doing them because you don't think that that is the problem. So therefore you stop doing it and you go back to an old behavioral pattern, and then we just reintroduce the same thing. So come join Movement Ayahuasca, guys. It's gonna be fun.
It's just breath work.
It's just breath work. Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. It is not just breath work. The Croatian music sounds like Mexican music. All right, let's rock and roll.